haven't spoken yet.
Good evening. I'm Sushma Raman. I'm the Executive Director of the Carr Center for Human Rights Policy. It's a privilege to welcome you all today here for a conversation with the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights. I'd like to introduce our moderator and facilitator for today's conversation, Dr. Catherine Sicking. She's the Ryan Family Professor of Human Rights Policy at the Kennedy School and the Carol K. Forsheimer Professor at the Radcliffe Institute for Advanced Study. Dr. Sicking works on international norms and institutions, transnational advocacy networks, the impact of human rights laws and policies, and transitional justice. We're very proud and pleased to welcome Dr. Sicking and our guest, the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights. Thank you.
Well, it's really a pleasure for us to be able to welcome the High Commissioner here. And Prince Zeid Raad Al Hussein was appointed to the post of High Commissioner in September 2014. And before that, he was Jordan's permanent representative to the United Nations. The High Commissioner has extensive experience in multilateral diplomacy, and in particular in an area that's actually very close to my own heart because it's very close to my own research area, and that is the establishment of the International Criminal Court. He chaired complex, pioneering negotiations as part of the development of the International Criminal Court, especially around issues of the elements of the individual crimes, which sounds very technical, but was a really important part of the negotiations. And then in 2002, he was elected as first president of the Assembly of States Parties of the International Criminal Court. And we have in the audience here Luis Moreno Campo, who was the first prosecutor of the International Criminal Court. So I know from his testimony what an incredibly supportive and essential role you played as the president of the Assembly of States Parties. But here, his career in multilateral diplomacy goes back much further than that. He was a political affairs officer of the UN Protection Force in the former Yugoslavia from 1994 to 1996. And he worked intimately on peacekeeping issues for over 19 years, notably as one of Secretary Ban Ki-moon's five eminent experts on his senior advisory group that had to do with reimbursement of countries contributing troops to peacekeeping. Following widespread allegations of abuse committed by UN peacekeepers in 2004, he was appointed by Kofi Annan as advisor to the Secretary General on sexual exploitation and abuse. This is an incredibly important issue for the United Nations. He also served as president of the UN Security Council, chair of the Security Council's committees on the DRC and on Liberia, Jordan's Sherpa following the Washington Summit on Nuclear Security, and chair of the Consultative Committee for the UN Development Fund on Women. He's also a member of the advisory committee to the Institute for Historical Justice and Reconciliation, based in The Hague. So as you can see, his career has touched virtually all key diplomacy topics, and we feel very privileged to have him here. The High Commissioner holds a Bachelor in Arts from the Johns Hopkins University and a doctorate degree from Cambridge University Christ College. He was also presented in 2008 with an honorary doctorate by the Southern California Institute for his work on behalf of international justice. So we're very privileged to have you here. And we have a series of questions that are going to try to touch on some of the crucial issues that you are facing as High Commissioner. And I hope you'll forgive us for beginning with a topic very much in our news, and that is U.S. Presidential elections. What should be the priority of the U.S. administration vis-a-vis human rights challenges that the world is facing? And what should be the domestic human rights concerns of a new U.S. president?
Well, first of all, Catherine, thank you very much for the warm introduction. And I'm delighted to be here. I'm delighted to be seeing Louise and so many friends, including my son. My son is 14 years old and attends Groton School, and his headmaster and Mrs. Macobella are with him. And for me, it's a special treat because he's forced to listen to his father at age 14. I tell you, this is a treat for me. But to see so many other friends with whom I've worked with over the years, it's a special delight. When you mentioned the honorary degree I received from this law school in Santa Barbara, if I can just, before I get serious on these issues, I was very honored when they sent me the letter, and I traveled to Santa Barbara, and I presided over the commencement ceremony, and then had the honor of meeting the faculty for dinner. And one of the faculty members said to me, may we broach a sensitive issue with you? And I said, yes, please go ahead. They said, we're bankrupt. I said, what? They said, we're bankrupt, and will you buy us? And I thought, so you mean I just received an honorary degree from a bankrupt institution as a means of enticing me to buy? I said, I'm not that sort of prince, if you, that's what you think. I'm bankrupt myself, so please don't go there. In any case, I think the issues of the moment, of course, are the extreme rhetoric being used by at least two, but not maybe not restricted to two, of the presidential candidates, that when judged or seen from Europe, of course, finds a direct counterpart with some of the rhetoric that is being used in the Central and Eastern European states, but not limited to. And of course, it's so incendiary because we believe, at least in the human rights world, that it's not without consequence that you can say these things. And it's not the politician that will be made to pay for the comments that they make. It will be, at the end of the day, some vulnerable group or community that will feel the effect. We've seen this time and again throughout the course of human history. How many times do we have to repeat that one supports wholly the exercise of the freedom of expression, and it must be given wide berth, but when the intent is to sow a disruptive atmosphere, when the intent is to free oneself from blame for all that we see around us and place the blame firmly on the shoulders or in the lap of a community that is not responsible for the chaos that we see, I think this is disgraceful. It is very important, I think, for the US and especially for Americans to continue to resist this sort of rhetoric. It doesn't mean we need to have a sanitized space where nothing can be said. I think it has to be said, though, with the realization that past historical experience has informed us and led us to a point where we must be more responsible in how we speak about these issues. I think this is the issue of the day. I have to also add, because I think we stand to be accused often at the UN that we're so self-righteous, as someone once said of us, that we're these sort of self-appointed angels, that we must also recognize the UN is not, as you pointed out, you know, this infallible organization that can't do anything or get anything wrong. We have many challenges we have to face, not least the issue of sexual exploitation and abuse in peacekeeping, which is absolutely horrific, and every day we see more allegations surface, and the UN is struggling to deal with this. It is appalling. So I say and make these comments with some humility, of course.
Thank you. You have said that poverty is one of the underlying causes of violations of civil, political, economic, social, and cultural rights. And we know now that the world's 1% has more wealth than the rest of the world combined. Now, what are the implications of such drastic economic inequality? We know that human rights law and human rights movements have been very effective in contributing to a decline of other forms of inequality, gender inequality, racial inequality, inequality with regard to sexual orientation. So what can be a human rights approach to addressing economic inequality?
Yeah, you know, if you look at the literature within the world of development economics, If you look at, just pick up your, you know, weekend or the weekly edition of The Economist or the daily edition of the Financial Times, the Wall Street Journal, seldom will you ever see these two words, human rights, included in the text. You go to Davos, human rights doesn't figure in anything that Davos does, those two words. You go to many fora where business interests are concerned. There's this fear that if you invoke human rights, you are going to deter some of the countries, most notably China, perhaps Russia, some of the Asian African countries from attending, and so you just don't use this language. And we speak of the differentiated, or let's say the categories of rights. We speak of women's rights, and we speak of children's rights. But human rights is something that's still sort of rather esoteric and so doesn't qualify for a discussion almost. The point that you're raising, it was brought home to me only the other day. I was having dinner with someone who is heavily involved with a private equity firm, and he was saying to me, I mean, the world is awash with liquidity. And yet 2 days later, we were discussing the Zika virus at the UN, and we have no funding with which to help the affected countries, 57 and growing. The vector needs to be brought under control, and we still are far away from that. The vaccination for it is still 2 years off. And in the meantime, the evidence is beginning to cement our belief that the link between the Zika virus and microcephaly is there. And when you look at the affected countries, there is no infrastructure when it comes to, or not the sort of infrastructure you need when it comes to healthcare in many of the rural areas, no possibility that in the short term we can have the right rehabilitation clinics for those who require disability care in the long term. And so we are hard pressed to find now solutions to try and address this crisis. And we barely have any monies. The UN is filled with depleted funds, and I would think for many of the other agencies, it's a very similar story. Mm-hmm. And yet, on the other side, the capital markets, I think, are valued at 36 trillion and plus, mm-hmm. and the world is obscenely sort of in imbalance. And we cannot hope to address one side if we don't have the import and support of the other. But there must be a deeper recognition, and John Ruggie here at the Kennedy School has done extraordinary work to tie in the need for business to be more human rights sensitive and the well-being of the planet in the future.
Mm-hmm. On the topic of Zika, I just want to mention, I want to tell you that earlier this week on Monday, my Kennedy School students in our human security class, and there may be some in the audience here, presented on Zika as a human security threat and a women's health threat. Yeah. And so we've been thinking about that issue. Something else that has been very much on the agenda, and in fact I just read a blog posting about it this morning, is around the world, governments are starting to attack civil society human rights organizations, yeah. What we call closing the space. Yeah. And they're making them register as foreign agents, they're blocking funding, and basically it's increasingly difficult for human rights organizations, especially in authoritarian societies, but even in some democratic or semi-democratic societies, to operate freely. So I wondered, one, what are your thoughts about this, and what can be done about it, and what can the High Commissioner's Office help do about it?
Yeah, I mean, we're very troubled by this. Normally in September, or let's say June, September, and March, I would, in my address to the member countries of the UN, and more particularly the Human Rights Council, I would enumerate the countries where we see a shrinking space for dissent. And back in September, there were so many that I couldn't do it. It would have taken 10 minutes just to reel off the names of the countries. And the vast majority of countries, we see real pressures on the civil society of the sort that we need, where they can hold governments to the mark. To have compliant civil society, to have civil society which basically praises government, well, that we have plenty of, and we have these gongos the world over. But NGOs that are still independent and can work with lawyers' associations, can work with journalists, they are shrinking very and disappearing very quickly. We are alarmed about this. The destructive power of the counter-terrorism, the countering extremist violence narrative, is that it claims many victims with it. It's not as precise as it should be, and civil society is suffering the blows from repressive regimes that will use quite happily this mood, this anti-terrorism mood, to destroy the voices and the critiques, or let's say the criticisms of various groups in society. I don't know where we're going to be in 20 years' time. When I was in Mexico, I was talking to civil society, and they spoke very clearly and very passionately about their issues. But I have spoken to the authorities there that we need to keep that space open. I don't want to be going back to the country at some stage and seeing that the voices have shrunk in terms of their ability to communicate. And that can be said of many, many countries. So it is a huge challenge, and it's something that we all need to work together with. It's not something that my office alone can address. It's something that we must bind together with national human rights institutions, ombudspersons, and push this agenda forward and be vocal about it and be quite aggressive about it, dare I say.
Well, and taking one concrete example where this has been a very serious issue, and let's look at the situation in Russia. And I understand that not only is it difficult for the High Commissioner to push back on that, but there's some threat that your offices in Russia are going to be closed. Is that?
That's true. We were informed by the Russian authorities that they were closing our office. We were rather unhappy about it. I believe that if we were going to close the office, we should at least be in agreement that we have concluded our work there and that we jointly decide to close it. We were told that the decision was taken. The Russian Federation is a sovereign entity. We are just an international organization, and thank you very much, you are to leave. I think it's worth making the point, however, that of the permanent five members of the Security Council, it was only in Moscow that we had an office in the first place. So I want to put this in perspective. But we were unhappy for the reasons you cite. We have very deep concerns about the state of civil society in the Russian Federation and elsewhere. And as you said, the exporting of the foreign agents law, of the undesirable organizations law to many countries, again, is a sharing of worst practices when it comes to throttling the voice of dissent. And so we think a threat to international peace and security eventually, because you're pushing societies toward extremes, basically.
Just to mention another case where another P5 member is also not cooperating with the human rights institutions of the United Nations, the United States has refused to permit the special rapporteur on torture, Juan Mendes, to be able to visit Guantanamo in the conditions he requires. What can we as Americans do to try to pressure our own government to make sure that we're cooperating with the United Nations?
Well, I think it's as a champion of human rights, the human rights agenda, and the U.S. does take forward leading positions on many, many issues. What we'd really like to see is the U.S. accede to the remaining conventions and the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, the Convention on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, the Rome Statute of the ICC, and clearly the optional protocol regarding the Convention Against Torture, which would then enable the subcommittee to visit places of detention. But if that's not going to happen soon, then yes, clearly an open or standing invitation to the Special Rapporteur on Torture would be something very welcomed. We need to see examples of forward-leading human rights supporting measures on the part of many countries, as opposed to viewing this as rather esoteric and viewing human rights as something that seems to be almost extreme and difficult to understand. Today, we saw in the news that the judge in respect of Breivik in Norway had concluded that Breivik's human rights were violated. And to many, this appalling mass killer, you probably would believe that they're not deserving of any rights, of course, and to try and convey to them that even in the case of this mass killer, there must be certain values that society, the international community, will maintain in the face of past crimes, which were absolutely horrific. And I think we would like to see the USCIS open up Guantanamo and other places of detention to the UN Special Rapporteur.
There's been a lot of attention to the, and deserved attention to the refugee crisis in Europe, Syrian and Iraqi and other refugees. But what some people may not be aware, though it was discussed in an event here in the forum earlier this semester, is that the great bulk of refugees are actually still in the region, and especially in Jordan, Lebanon, and Turkey. And so I wondered here, maybe thinking both as High Commissioner, but also thinking as a Jordanian, if you can tell us, you know, what can be accomplished with the refugee crisis, and especially in countries that are most pressed, which are really the countries of the region.
You know, I thought this was going to be, someone said to me, this is going to be a really easy interview. I feel like I'm being subjected to an oral examination. Nothing easy about all of this. No, there's no question that the countries neighboring Syria, I mean, from the very early stages of this crisis, have shown extraordinary generosity in receiving the people of Syria. The borders, by and large, remained open. Notwithstanding the enormous responsibility of hosting these refugees, there was no attempt to close the border early on. And what we see happening now is that over the last year and a half, a sort of mean-spiritedness has entered into this, into the way that the international community is viewing migrants and refugees that traditionally throughout the course of history have been a source for good, for building communities, for building countries. And now there's a sort of inversion, and instead they're viewed with great suspicion as threats, and the populist rhetoric in Europe in particular, and I've commented about the role of the tabloids in the United Kingdom, have conditioned segments of the population into taking a very negative approach. And quite frankly, I mean, I don't know how the common market is going to work in the future in Europe if they feel they cannot fence Europe off, and so they have to have internal controls. I think the economy of Europe is going to be in very deep trouble, let alone the effects of Brexit and what it means and the condition of the European banks. But what we want to see is somehow a more humane attitude being part of the discussion. I've had very difficult discussions with the Australian government, for example, on the way that the regional processing centers in Nauru and Papua New Guinea have created this impression that somehow Australia successfully managed the sort of Asian boat people experience. In actual fact, as we've found out time and again, they have become centers for abuse. The people in Papua New Guinea, no one really wants to go elsewhere to a third country. They all want to go to Australia. And it's not a threat to the Australian continent to open up its attitude toward receiving and resettling many of these people. I think the problem is that for many who contrive in their imagination an eventual threat, it creates an impediment in terms of then explaining to those people that no, you know, humanity has a way of self-adjusting. And you don't have to fear that you're going to all be swamped by people from other countries and you lose your identity. It doesn't really work like that. And I think this is the point that we're trying to make. We do have problems, with the EU-Turkey deal for a variety of reasons. We don't believe Turkey is a safe third country for returning migrants, and they have not acceded to this 67 protocol, which would extend protective status to refugees who are not from Europe. And these measures we have to negotiate with the Turks. But it is something that worries us. The xenophobia, the racism is now almost it's absolutely glaring, and very dangerous, of course.
Well, I am going to. I have another question here I want to ask you, but I want to use this moment to also alert the audience that here at the forum, it's really important that we devote our last 25 or 30 minutes to questions and answers. And so I want to get people thinking that after this next question and answer, you're going to have the opportunity to go to the mics that are here back in the back of the room and also are up here on the risers. So start thinking about your questions and be prepared to get in line to ask them, because you have, as you see, an expert here who just can answer any human rights question that you might want to ask. And so now you have talked, my last question is this, you've talked about the practice of human rights window dressing and the need for implementation and real change, and not just ratifying treaties and agreements. So what is the role of your office in ensuring that such implementation and change happens at the ground level?
Yeah, there seems to be a preoccupation by many governments of just satisfying appearance. You know, you ratify a particular convention, you pass a particular law, but then you're not making available a budget to ensure that there's a campaign to sensitize the public to what the law means, a campaign to extend legal aid, a campaign to ensure that all the regulations that need to be amended or conceived of are then indeed amended and conceived of. And so what happens is that the public becomes completely disenchanted. They see a government ratify a particular treaty or accede to a particular protocol, but at the level of district, at the level of the individual, there is no perceptible change. And the intensity of the frustration is there. And they will say, yes, you know, we may have heard in Colombo that these issues are being picked up, but here in Jaffna, we have seen very little. And you hear this in many, many countries that you travel to. And I think the point is, unless human rights are consequential at the level of individual, at the level of a district, then it becomes just a topic for debate and doesn't go beyond. And I think this is the key. I mentioned Mexico earlier. I had this extraordinary meeting with a large number of senators in Mexico from the opposition and from the government. And I was treated to this wonderful exchange, a detailed exchange, a thoughtful exchange between the two parties. And the government, basically the ruling party, was saying, we think we've done enough in respect of human rights in Mexico. The opposition was saying, we have not done nearly enough. There is a long way to go and we have a crisis. And I was asked the question of how I saw this. And I said that I believe the only ones who will ever be able to say that the Mexican government has done enough, it's not the Mexican government itself, neither is it the UN, it may be the opposition, but it's the people of Mexico who will say that the government has done enough. And if we don't hear them say that they've done enough, they haven't done enough. And that goes for every country that we deal with. And the point is that at the end, it has to be consequential, whether it be we deal with disability rights, the rights of children, the rights of women, and so forth.
Well, thank you very much. I see, actually, I have just a few moments left, so I'm going to ask you the last question on my list here, but and that is that the issue, we're very interested here in the Kennedy School in issues of technology and information. And we see that they're transforming the business world and the nonprofit world. And so how can the human rights movement and global human rights institutions best channel technology and innovation to promote human rights. So how do, can we be more consequential if we do a better job using technology and innovation?
The office that I have the privilege of leading, and really it's sort of the earliest stages of what Luis Moreno Campo eventually had to deal with in the work that he did at the International Criminal Court, conducts a series of inquiries, fact-finding missions, and there are the independent commissions of inquiry. And often we're in receipt of, for instance, video evidence, which seems to be in plentiful supply. But we didn't have the means to analyze it properly. And so we began a discussion with Microsoft a few years ago, and they have been helping us not just analyze it, but find experts who can also go further into the material. And eventually, this would be part of the evidentiary basis on which you then will have criminal investigations and beyond that, hopefully, prosecutions of individuals thought to have committed these crimes. So clearly there's a role. We depend on satellite technology and other forms of communication also. When we don't have access to a particular site, that we somehow are able through third parties to get hold of that information. So it's still work in progress, and all of you who are interested in this, you know, we would love to avail ourselves of your talents and your brilliance and for the sake of human rights and furthering justice in the world today.
Thank you very much. Okay, now people know. So we do have people already at the mics, and so we're gonna go back and forth from one mic to another, and people can just get in line. So why don't we start here, and I do have instructions. We'd like everyone to identify yourself. We'd like one brief question per person, no speeches, questions, and the questions end with a question mark.
No opinions, it's fine. Is this on? Okay, hi, thank you so much for coming and giving us this opportunity for discussion. My name is Matteo Cumuletti, and I go to the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. I'm in a class now on peacekeeping operations, and I don't mean to bring up a kind of a tragic topic, but of course we've had so many accusations of sexual exploitation and abuse, and something that's not quite as often in the media are the children born of the victims of sexual exploitation and abuse, the kind of term of peacekeeper babies. And I have read that like a couple of years ago, the UN started to give out DNA tests and give child support through the troops salaries, but I don't know, has there been any sort of comprehensive strategy from the UN to deal with this victim population, or does the responsibility lie solely with the troop contributing countries to kind of support the children and the mothers?
Yeah, it's a superb question, this, because it sort of falls in the crack between the responsibilities of the organization and then the sort of jurisdiction that can only be exercised by the sending state in respect of military forces. And there was a proposal that came out of the Secretariat 10 years ago, and I supported it when I was the advisor to the Secretary General on this subject, which basically had it that anyone serving in the field should give a sample of their DNA before they served. And this went for military as well as for civilians. So one, of course, to act as an obvious deterrent, to avoid, you know, ending up in situations where there are abuses like this. And second, in the event that there was an allegation, a determination could quickly be made whether there was at least the prima facie grounds for culpability. But this, sadly, was rejected by the member governments. At the moment, we're sort of moving ahead and sort of trying to push the ball here a little bit, because the reputational risk for the UN is appalling, but that's minor compared to the major disaster, which is what you allude to, is having these children fathered by UN peacekeepers for whom there is no support. And it's just, you know, completely unacceptable, this. But the attempts to get a victims fund fully supported have not produced the sorts of results that we've wanted. And I think sustained media attention on this is probably required for us to get there in the future. But excellent question, thank you.
I want to turn here.
Brock Adler. I work in environmental education policy. Thank you for your good work. We've been talking a lot of challenges. Give us a good news story, not just to make us feel good, but so we can hear how the United Nations in your office has helped, you know, make some progress. Thank you.
Yeah. You know, it's so difficult in the work that we do to see all the positive trends. And Catherine spoke of, you know, the broader arc, the fact that we do see greater numbers of women entering schools. We have seen a broader acceptance of LGBT as a community that is on equal par with the rest of us when it comes to rights. We do see a growing community of those who will support disability rights. And all of that is something we take pride in. And what really sustains us, I mean, what really keeps us going is these amazing human rights defenders. I mean, I cannot tell you what it's like to sit with someone who's quite prepared to go to jail time and again, not to see their families, possibly never to emerge from jail, and yet they will not stop talking, and they will resist pressure from the governments, and they will do so on the an honorable basis. And it's phenomenal. The other day I met a lady who is diminutive in size, you know, about 4 foot five, with a backbone of steel. She has been threatened time and again from various quarters over the last 25 years. And I said to her, will you ever stop speaking about these issues? And she said, absolutely not. And when you see that it is a huge source, first of all, of inspiration. But you realize that people who are changing the agenda are not really people like me who will do the speaking and do the media interviews, but it's people like her and them who will change and inspire the world to better things. And I think this is what keeps us going. And if you haven't met them, I'll introduce you to some of them, and they're extraordinary people and really need to be celebrated much more than they are. They're very modest, most of them, of course, and don't seek the limelight, but extraordinary people. Yeah. Thank you.
I'm going to move to the mic right up there.
Great, thank you. My name is Rashan Muhammad. I'm a master's in public administration student here at the Kennedy School. My question to you is about internet access. Are we at the point as a global society yet where we can call access to an uncensored internet, or even more broadly speaking, access to the internet in general, as a human right?
Yeah, it's a very good point. I mean, it's almost like access to banking. You know, there's no right to banking, and yet banks can take decisions just almost arbitrarily sometimes to deny you, you know, services. And I'm sure we're getting to that point sometime soon. The key point will be in September when we move past ICANN or we see what the US government is going to do, because as you know, the internet would be sort of almost floated. It'd be a multi-stakeholder community that will manage the internet that has hitherto been managed by the US. And I think we're fast approaching a point there where so essential will it be that privacy rights are maintained, the space is maintained, because so much of your life would be tethered to the internet, that we may well get there at some point, not soon. The difficult point really is to see how we're not thinking in enlightened ways. I mean, if we took the Torture Convention or the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and we tried to negotiate today the same terms, only the same terms that we had in 1948 or 1951 or 49, we couldn't do it. And you know, there is something happening to us. And so as I said to the Human Rights Council, high steam pressure is being fed into this chamber. And we don't know exactly how this is going to rupture. But it will rupture at some stage unless we begin to think more clearly about how we address the problems of this planet with some sort of sane use of dialogue, and not take it to extreme emotions and passions and doesn't get us anywhere. And the rise of ethnic nationalism or nationalisms of that sort is really very worrisome, extremely worrisome. And if there is one thing that the UN stands for, I mean, United Nations, what does it mean? It's another way of saying working together. If we're not working together, we can't solve these problems. But that was, thank you for the question. It was good. You prompted me to think, to go back to my office and ask the question myself. Yeah. It's good.
Yes, up here.
Thank you for coming here and sharing your insights and also all the work that you do and your organization do. My name is Mong Niu, and I'm a doctoral candidate in the Graduate School of Education. My question is regarding human rights of indigenous people. Many parts of the world today, indigenous people are subject to numerous human rights violations. Even though there is a UN Forum for Indigenous Rights, their plea fell into deaf ear because of this window dressing that you mentioned, window dressing of human rights. And particular instance I can share, I'm from Bangladesh. Indigenous people, government even doesn't recognize that has been militarized from 1976 up to today. And government issued something, it says, any tribesman wants to speak with foreigner must be in the presence of military officers. So when a commute happened like this, what UN organizations, what are your strategies for indigenous people around the world? And my second question is, what you can recommend for students like at Harvard and also other institutions, universities around the world can do to be the voice for those who have been silenced and to bring hope to the places there is little or no hope? Thank you.
Well, I mean, the short answer is always to speak out, of course. It's easy to say, very difficult to do in the face of so many pressures and threats to you if you do. And most recently, we've been very concerned about the attacks on those speaking for the rights of indigenous people in Honduras. And we see this as a trend that will continue unless we're able to put a check to it. We're working very closely with the World Bank that are revising. You have this process of revising the safeguards currently underway at the bank. It's essential for us that the bank is not seen as somehow, you know, funding or promoting discrimination. The projects that the bank finances and funds are of vital importance to many countries, not least, of course, to those who live in extreme poverty. But we want to see an execution of the and implementation of the projects that the rights of communities like indigenous communities are not just trampled on or run roughshod over, that proper processes of consultations that dignify those people are honored. So it's again work in progress. The more of you who write about this, the more of you who publish articles on this in scholarly journals and elsewhere, the more we can keep sustained pressure on this very important subject. And I'm glad you raised it. Thank you.
Great. Yes, over here.
Hi, my name is Angel Cabrera. I'm a master's student at law school. And previously I was a human rights advocate in Mexico, and my question regards Mexico. So as you surely know, there's been this back and forth between the human rights movement and the Mexican government, personally, the Juan Mendez, the Inter-American system, and also internally, some human rights advocates has been criminalized recently. So there's this type of repression from the side of the government, and the human rights movement is also being attacked by organized crimes. So if the human rights movement in Mexico is getting entrenched between these two sides, I just wanted your opinion on what the United Nations High Commissioner can do on this situation, or how does it perceive it after your visit to Mexico?
Well, what we are waiting now is the results of the interdisciplinary group, which is part of the investigative team that was sent by the Inter-America Commission to investigate Iguala, or the disappearance of the 43 students, the Ayotzinapa case. The results of the investigation, I believe, are being released on the 24th of this month. Ourselves, Juan Mendez, the special rapporteur on torture, the working group on enforced disappearances, the Inter-America Commission, and the Mexican Human Rights Commission have all spoken about the need to properly understand in detail what happened to these 43 students, because this is very much an emblematic case. There were plenty of demonstrations in Mexico on this, and I think if we properly understand what happened in that case, it would unlock many of the other cases and reveal where the Mexican government really must focus its attention. There has been some progress, again, on the legislative side, but what we really need to see is implementation. We need to see the stop on an end to the attacks on journalists. We need to see the rule of law properly supported, the Attorney General's office. And I have spoken about the fact that 98% of all criminal cases in Mexico go unsolved, and that figure needs to be brought down. But you know, as I said, civil society is still very active. It's so important for the Mexican state that that remain the case. But they are under pressure, and particularly in the states where there has been tremendous violence. I hope that you go back with your Harvard education, that you continue to do your work. Please don't be dragged into the corporate world or anywhere like that. You know, stick to it. I'll come to visit you, and we together with our friends, and there are many in the Mexican government who are fully supportive of doing the right thing, of course, and we will hopefully be able to change the situation.
As someone who's had Angel in a class, I can assure you that he won't leave the cause of human rights. yes, Patricia.
Yes, hi. Good afternoon. Thank you so much for being here and for your comments. My name is Patricia Garcia Rios. I work here at the Kennedy School creating video and curriculum materials for classroom use, a lot of them for human rights courses. You've talked about nationalism, the rise of nationalism, and this kind of heightened rhetoric, not just here in the US, but in other countries, as we've seen. And it seems to me, I keep having this sense that from those of us who don't share that opinion, it's very easy to dismiss it as very simplistic, a very simplistic view of the world. But we are in a juncture right now where if things don't go well, we could end up with a lot of governments that come into power with that mandate, with a population that's, you know, at least right now, vocally supporting these very radical and not, human rights-oriented solutions, not just here, but, you know, we have Hungary, we have Poland, we could have Germany, we could have other countries. So in your office, from your position, do you see a way to start engaging with those populations who dismiss human rights as a sort of frivolous or, you know, just unnecessary or politically correct, whatever they may call it, name, and trying to convey the messaging in a different way that they will understand and maybe also listen to their concerns? And I feel as long as we keep talking about human rights and they keep talking about something else, there's never going to be a connection made there. So I'm interested in your thoughts about that. Thank you.
We try to invoke historical example, and you can draw some lessons from it. Of course, you're never going to have the exact replica of the same circumstances that brought about an event, 70 years ago. But for instance, when looking at the debate over migration in Brussels or in many of the European Union capitals, it struck me that the language used was very similar to what we saw or what we see in the intergovernmental debate that took place at the Evian conference in July of 1938, where many countries were brought to the table by FDR to decide on how Europe could assist in terms of absorbing the German and Austrian Jewry that were being forced out of Germany and Austria after the Anschluss, most particularly. And FDR recognized that there had to be a sort of global solution to this. And as you recall, the people were put on boats and just sent out into the Mediterranean, and they had to find safe harbor. But FDR himself was not willing to tackle Congress in raising the cap of, I think, about 22,000 that the US had set for itself. the expectation before Evian was that the US would accept 600,000, and then everyone else would be sort of, by dint of example, have to follow suit and raise the numbers. When they saw that the US delegation was not going to go very high, then everyone basically came up with the language that we see so prevalent today, that European societies are still reeling from the Great Depression. They still had to deal with the effects of the Second World War. They didn't want to import Germany and Austria's problems. I think it was the delegate from Australia who said, we don't want to import Germany's racial problems into Australia. And so many countries basically then didn't take any of those who were escaping or being forced out of Germany and Austria. And I've written about this, I've spoken to the Europeans at length, I've spoken in public, and many of them are extremely uncomfortable when you invoke the past like this, because they will say, you know, we have the European Union, the Second World War is a long time ago, we've moved, we have institutions, we have Strasbourg, we have the European Court, please don't go back there. The point is not to deny that all of this exists now, these institutions exist, and Strasbourg is active. The point is that the rhetoric is practically the same. And the not seeing that is I think, for me, quite astonishing. And I think it's just trying to inject some sort of sanity here. You know, the laws that were created, the conventions that were negotiated and decided upon, were the product and distillation of human experience over the last three or four centuries. Customary law had brought us to the point where we had to codify some of this. And we knew from experience that if we don't settle this somehow through law, that we will continue to have countries as well as leaders or led by leaders who will rationalize any particular action. And that's why the torture convention has an absolute prohibition on the use of torture. Absolute prohibition. No exceptions. No unique circumstances. No changing sort of alignments and asymmetric warfare can justify that. And if it is the case, and I was talking this morning to Alberto, he's sitting right in front of me, if it is the case that, you know, 7 out of 10 Americans believe that torture, you know, can be employed, or there are grounds for employing it, I think we're in serious trouble. I think we're in serious trouble. I don't know, we were discussing how the question was framed, but I clearly we cannot go back to those times. And so somehow you hope that there's a pause, and you hope that there's enough of a reaction. I mean, what is encouraging about the migration crisis is, yes, there have been bigoted leaders and racists of various political stripes, but mostly on the right, who will say the most appalling things. And in the face of that, you still have publics who will do the right thing, whether in Greece, whether in Macedonia, whether in Austria or Germany, you know, very much against the government line. And that fills us with hopes. And it's not just in Europe, but in other countries as well. And we have to sort of, going back to the positive story, we have to tap into the, you know, the sense that still resides in the hearts of many.
Yes.
My name is Kelly Reddy, and I want to thank you so much for your comments. They're very uplifting at a time where we probably all need a little uplifting. Specifically, your comments on indigenous people and human rights defenders made me, and then your referral to Honduras made me think of Berta Castillejos,
yeah, who I'm exactly sure. Exactly, that's what I meant to.
Yeah. Yeah. But I want to ask you to be a little bit more specific on a topic that you've talked about, and which obviously causes you a lot of anguish, and that is the sexual exploitation of women by peacekeepers, because, as you said, it completely undermines everything that the UN is trying to do. What is being done? I mean, this has been a long-standing problem. What is being done at the UN to address this problem?
Yeah, in a very simple way, the UN not being a sovereign body, right, unless by decree, let's say by a decision of the UN Security Council to create an ad hoc tribunal to try UN personnel, which in the current circumstances is almost zero possibility. It's only the governments that can subject these people to a criminal investigation and then subsequently to punishment post-conviction. The UN can dismiss them from service for violating some administrative regulation, but if you've been engaged in sexual abuse of the worst kind, and we've seen this for many, many years, it's simply not good enough that the UN can just send you back home. And the governments concerned have to do their part. But most are unwilling. It's beginning to change, but most traditionally have been unwilling to do it because it brings great shame to themselves and so forth. And then what they do, sadly, is they use this ridiculous thing, naming and shaming. It's not naming and shaming. They have shamed themselves by not pursuing this properly. And we then name. But they sort of reverse the burden as if it's the UN shouldn't be calling out member states to do their job. And I think this is what we need to do. We had to think in terms of how you provide some jurisdictional coverage for civilians, because we have this problem on the civilian side as well. The funds and agencies also have this problem. And so there's a draft convention sitting there in the UN for 10 years, and it hasn't been moved. And so when governments say to me, High Commissioner, we do something, and I said to them, you have to do something. You have to move this convention. And you need to push this. And so it's very frustrating. Sorry, Kelly, go ahead.
What's the name of the convention?
It's the Convention on Criminal Accountability. And it was put together, proposed by a Singaporean lawyer who worked with us on the Rome Statute, a brilliant Singaporean lawyer. And he looked at all, together with his team, all various permutations of what could be done. But it's so frustrating, of course, for us to continuously receive it. I mean, the most appalling allegations. Yeah. And we need to get past it. And we will continue to strive in that direction, of course.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Maybe you can share is that the text of that could be shared with us?
Yeah,
here?
It's on the website. It's on the UN website. And it's in the Sixth Committee, the Legal Committee. So yeah, anything you can write about it and raise a fuss about it, you can use me as a reference or put me in the text or whatever it is, however helpful I can be to you. Thank you.
Rodrigo.
Yes, so thank you. I'm from Venezuela. My name is Rodrigo Diamante. I'm a student of this great school. I'm also living in the exile. I was a political prisoner 2 years ago. Thanks to global support, I'm here right now. So, but my question is, the Venezuelan government hasn't complied to any of the decisions made by the UN, any of the dictates. So why we should continue going to the UN? Why we should keep trusting in this if we haven't seen any change? For us, it's very difficult to find the funds, although submit all this information, but we still have the 82 political prisoners. I also want to thank you for your comments on supporting the amnesty law to liberate the political prisoners in Venezuela. But what is your message for the civil society in Venezuela?
Yeah, it's Venezuela is going through a very difficult time. I mean, today, the announcement that the power outages are something, that, or not so much power outages, but there would be restrictions on the use of electric power, I think, again, is driving Venezuelan society to the very edge. We were hopeful that the Supreme Court would rule in the right direction when it came to the draft bill before the National Assembly, which would have released a large number of detainees that we believed were arbitrarily detained. And so it came as a big disappointment for us when this was not the case. We will continue to advocate for a free judiciary or independent judiciary in Venezuela. I think that's absolutely the key. We're not convinced, and the mechanisms, the human rights mechanisms, are not convinced that this is the case. And we have to keep in contact both with the Venezuelan authorities, but with many others who also want to see the right changes come to Venezuela in respect of the judiciary, the release of detainees, a more open dissenting climate available for everyone to participate in shaping the future of the country. And it clearly is moving in a very worrisome trajectory. I hope that at one stage soon you too will be back home and I'll come and visit you and we'll talk about how we can push this forward. I have offered to visit Venezuela a number of times, but no invitation has come to me yet. We don't have a presence in Venezuela as such. The UN has a presence, but our office doesn't. But we will still continue to keep a sharp eye on events there. And there are many within the human rights community who are very concerned, of course. Thank you.
This is the time when we take the last question. So, yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your comments. My name is Ananda Paez. I'm a student at the Fletcher School. And well, the United Nations has repeatedly recognized the importance of having more women in the organization, especially in the higher ranks. And with all due respect to your work, I was personally very surprised that the first advisor on sexual exploitation and abuse was a man. So from your perspective and given your experience, what concrete steps do you think the UN has to take to include women in the organization and specifically in the higher levels? Thank you.
Well, clearly, appointment. We're very conscious about this, that we need to ensure that we have equal representation. And when it comes to appointments, clearly this is one of the factors that we bear in mind. They're the core competencies that must be first satisfied, and those are fairly well known. But then when you have equally gifted men and women applying for a post, then clearly we would want to favor the women candidates, but not at the expense of the core competencies that must be there. And fortunately, I'd like to say in the last two appointments, two out of three last appointments that I've made that we've made in our office, that there have been women, and very, of course, able UN, senior UN officials. And I think the point is, I think, well understood, and we have to look to examples like the Canadian government to sort of inspire all of us. You know, there is a point that I sometimes raise, and this is going to get me into trouble, but that's partly what I do. You know, there's a great push to have the next Secretary General a woman. And I think there's a great deal of support. We have many, many very gifted candidates who are applying who so happen to be women, and that's terrific. But it occurred to me that some of the countries on the UN Security Council, the Permanent Five, for example, you know, with the exception of the United States, you know, the others have had a continuous membership since 1946, and they've all been male. Why hasn't France nominated a female ambassador to be on the Security Council? Or the UK, or I mean Russia and China? And so there's so much of the work that we need to do which needs to balance this. I mean, there's again no shortage of gifted people who can occupy these posts and do a tremendous job. And you know, when I look for inspiration, Navi Pillay, who was my predecessor, you know, I came into this office and I, as a former diplomat, was thinking I could be slick and I could be tactical and maybe I would go in quietly in the beginning and see, reset some of the relationships because they were fraught between her and many governments. And I said, Navi, what do you suggest? And she just said, you just come out strong. You just come out strong. And you don't privilege any particular group of countries or any country. And you speak in defense of the victims, you speak in defense of vulnerable groups, but I found great inspiration with her example. And at the end, she was so strong. I mean, when I read her speech before the Security Council, the last speech, it was so strong. And I realized I was not going to speak in any subdued tones when I read her speech. And you know, she has been and together with Louise Arbour before her, you know, two extraordinary former judges who were extraordinary high commissioners for human rights. And I am privileged to follow in their footsteps. So I'm learning from them. Thank you.
Well, I want to thank you very much for your thoughtful responses and for your visit.
Thank you so much.
And we wish you the best with your difficult work.
Thank you so much.